Zoning Board of Appeals and a little public service announcement. Tonight's Zoning Board of Appeals meeting is being recorded for RCTV Live on channel Comcast 22 and Verizon Channel 33. Check rctv.org for more information and for replay time. All right, the first case is a continuation of an earlier case, case number 1615. We'll read the hearing notice, a continuation of a public hearing on the petition of Gary and Anne Marie Goodspeed, who seek a variance under section 5.5 accessory buildings of the zoning bylaws in order to construct an in-ground pool and accessory building on the property located at 155 Wakefield Street in Reading, Massachusetts. Unless there's an objection, I'll dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as well as all the pertinent departments and committees in town, members and associate members of the Board of Appeals, as well as the planning boards of surrounding towns. Testimony given before this board is taken under oath, so if you think you're going to speak, please stand and raise your right hand. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The response is I do. All right.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We're back from September. I believe we have the pool setback figured out. We did talk to Glenn, and I think that got all sorted out. Respectfully asking for a variance for the 6-foot setback from the cabana structure that was built without a permit as a family project. I mean, we've gone over the hardships. I didn't want it that close to the pool with the electric. The front of the lot does slope down, so there really wasn't a spot to put it in front and the aesthetics of the house, but wouldn't have done very good with the in-ground pool they had expanded in the front of the house. That's pretty much how that, that's pretty much all I can tell you.
Okay. All right. I know we have perhaps some comments or questions. Follow-up questions. I mean, we heard a little bit of this case back in September.
Right.
Bob, I don't know if you have anything you want to add or ask the applicant.
First of all, yeah, I think back in September, I was the one that was concerned about the pool being within the rear setback. I apologize. I see the building inspector has clarified that and noted because it's considered an accessory structure, it is required to be a minimum of 5 feet, and certainly you do have that on the pool. I think the pool is a non-issue right now.
Okay.
And the cabana, now you say, did I hear you just right that you did have a building permit for the cabana?
You did not. My father and my two boys built it as a family project, and we did not pull it for
it. I see. Okay. And now how long has that been there?
2.5 years.
2.5 years.
Yes.
Okay.
It came to light when we pulled the permit for the pool.
Nothing has been done.
That was an issue.
Okay, and it's other than the distance between the house and the cabana, which is 6 feet, required to be 10 feet.
Yes.
That's it. It meets the side yards and rear yards.
Yes.
On now. Okay. Let's see. As you said, the variance control is you have to meet the four criteria for a variance there. We'll go over that. Okay. No further questions.
No.
Okay. John.
I think that my concern too was along the line of Robert's, that the setback requirement, and I was concerned more about the deck of the pool, but I see in the email or the statement that Glenn sent us that he clarified the distance being from the water line rather than the grade deck to the rear lot line. And that is 5 feet, yours is accordingly 6 feet as it stands right now in the certified plot plan. So that, just like what Robert had said, I don't have a question. I do have some concerns about the cabana where it's located right now. You have more than, it looks like, more than sufficient room to move that cabana back so that it complies with the 10-foot setback. And having been built without a permit only 2.5 years ago, and then the requirements for the variance that you have listed here, especially the, I understand that you have less land in the back than you do in the front. Front is more than sufficient to put a pool cabana and a lot of other things out there, but the issue is that it is more appropriate to have a pool in the back than in the front.
The plot plan doesn't show is there is a rock wall of 4 feet that's right on the back corner of the cabana. So I pushed it back as far as I could to get to that wall. And unfortunately, it doesn't show it on the plot plan.
Well, I would still have problem, I guess, by not pulling the permit. Could have addressed that at a later, you know, during time. And all pools don't have to have a cabana, so it's an optional thing.
Okay.
But to stay within the consistency that we do on requirements for a variance, to me, this more or less fails the variance criteria. But that's the only concern that I have.
Yeah. All right. Ty?
Well, the only question I was going to raise was why did you put it where it is? Specifically.
Close to the house for the electrical and the gas, the propane tank is on the side of the house that we use for
right.
the inside of the
right.
house as well.
So we're looking at here is either we bless it where it is or
really
we force you to move it. It's as simple as that. And so I'm not going to have any more questions at this time.
Okay. Nick?
Just one question. You mentioned there's a rock wall in the land back around the cabana slopes down. Could you speak more to that?
The rock
about
wall,
about the land sloping?
The whole property slopes towards the towards the other abutters.
Okay.
And to make flat parcels, we had to put rock wall retaining walls just to kind of grade off the slope of the property.
So was that part of why the cabana is there as well? That just happened to be
yes.
a flat?
That just happens to be the flat piece of property
okay.
that we use the retaining walls to get to that flat section.
All right. And was there anywhere else further towards the rear of your yard that you could have put the cabana? Or was that all
sloping? There wasn't a spot
sloping
there. Everything slopes
okay.
away. That was the flat part. I couldn't have pushed it further over because there's a garage door in the back as well.
I see.
That
okay.
would have blocked that.
Got it. Okay, thanks.
All right, I'm going to, the building inspector did provide us with a statement that I'll read into the record regarding case 1615-155 Wakefield Street in-ground pool application. The proposed 20 by 38 in-ground pool does comply with the required setbacks of 5 feet. Setbacks required are to be determined from the waterline dimension of the pool, not the grade on not the on-grade deck. In addition, the distance required from the existing cabana without the benefit of a building permit should be determined from the exterior wall, not the roof overhang. The cabana wall structure is located 6 feet from the dwelling, where the current bylaw requires 10 feet. It is of my opinion that a variance is required for a 6 feet distance between the dwelling and the cabana rather than the required 10 feet, section 5.5 accessory buildings of the zoning bylaws. I wanted to just put that in the record. As we talked about, I think last time you were here, obtaining a variance, basically asking for forgiveness rather than for permission is a bit tricky. As well as the statutory framework, the four criteria for a variance, is a fairly high standard for applicants to meet, and you know, and it's a you know, the sloping nature of the rear yard, perhaps maybe deals with topography. I'm not sure about whether or not the other board members feel the same, but essentially, your I think side probably put it better, and that is, you know, we're either gonna bless the cabana that you put in without a permit or require you to move it. And so that's what we have to determine today. And so, you know, while this board is really great at providing suggestions and alternatives and trying to find real-world solutions for folks to do things in the alternative, that's not really the subject matter for a variance application. And while we go a little bit above and beyond and do that for folks, really what it comes down to is whether or not you meet the four criteria. Not whether or not it's the highest and best use or the most appropriate use is almost irrelevant to our analysis. It's does the use and the proposed application meet the four criteria? And that's where I'll end my comments. I'll open the hearing up to any public comment. Is there anybody here that would like to speak to this application from the public? If so, please rise, identify yourself by name and address, and address the board.
Sure. My name is Craig McKenna on 38 Arm Lane. I am an abutter to the Goodspeeds on 155 Wakefield Street. We've been neighbors for 10 years. I can attest to everything he talks about with the rock wall and where he ended up putting that cabana, knowing full well that there was really no other option to put it at that time. So, thank you.
All right. Thank you. Is there anybody else in the audience that would like to speak to the application? Hearing none, I'll close the public portion of the hearing. Are there any other comments or questions from members of the board?
Go ahead,
Bob.
Question in regards to the foundation for this cabana. How is this set on the ground? Is it on concrete sonotubes? Is it on a...
There are five posts, and they go down so 4 feet into the ground with the big foot.
Yeah.
I had Glenn come out and look at it.
So it's not a slab on grade?
It's a slab. It is on a slab, but the actual post holding up the roof and the structure around the...
Okay,
the
I'm talking...
Car.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking. It's set on a slab then, as opposed to like a deck on sonotubes.
The actual posts holding the roof up and the framing of the bar go 4 feet into the ground into Bigfoot sonotubes.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, so there's actually a concrete slab, and then the cabana itself is set
the
on
concrete
sonotubes.
The inner part of the cabana.
Right, you had to get 4 feet below grade there,
yes.
You know. My way of thinking, you know, that's what I say, the first criteria is the more difficult one to justify, most likely, but it sounds like from discussions and from, you know, your neighbor there talking and from what you've said, that the topography in your backyard sloped severely and you had to build leveled areas held up by retaining walls in order to get some level areas back there in your backyard.
Yes.
So I would tend to think, you know, if he were coming before us before the fact, that he would meet the uniqueness of the topography of the land, sloping steeply there. And I think he would then meet the other four criteria myself on that.
Thank you, Bob.
Yep.
Any other members of the board have any comment?
You said Glenn came out and took a look at it.
Yes.
When did he do that? Since the last meeting?
Before the last meeting.
Before the last meeting?
Yes, before the last meeting. I asked him to come out. He did come out to the site and did a site check. And he had said the foundation, everything, the building of it was fine for him.
Okay.
All right, next slide. Nick, John?
I'm still having trouble with the first criteria.
Mm.
Only because even though there is a grade differential, construction the way it is today could have, if you had known that it was 10 feet and came in for a actual permit, it would have been able to be done. Either you would have shrunk the cabana a little bit, or
it was actually 6 feet at the time when we built it. Glenn said, he said if you had done the permit, it would have been fine. It was 6 feet on the setback at the time you built it,
but you could have moved the you said you had retaining walls, but
the retaining walls were there from 8 years ago when we initially built the house. Those were already set there when the excavator was doing the dig out for the addition.
Okay.
Hey, Mike, anything else?
I'm all set.
I don't have anything either. I will then go ahead and entertain a motion from one of the board members. Bob, how about you?
Sure, I'll go ahead and do it. I'll make a motion in the case number 1615 on the petition of Gary and Emery Goodspeed, who seeks a variance under section 5.5 accessory buildings of the zoning bylaws in order to retain an existing accessory structure on the building of the property located on the property located at 155 Wakefield Street in Reading, in accordance or as shown on the certified plot plan prepared by John Sullivan, PE, Woburn, Massachusetts, and dated 2nd, 2016, and stamped by John Sullivan, registered surveyor, on that with a retain a distance of 6 feet, basically 6 feet from the existing residence, as shown on the plot plan, so noted. And it appears to me that the applicant has met the four criteria required for a variance, in that there is circumstances related to soil conditions at the rear of the property based on the steep topography of the land and the number of retaining walls. And the other three criteria also that appears that they've met.
All right, do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Cy.
Could, do we need to adjust or correct the notice that we posted it on, because right now it's listed as a variance from section 5.5 of accessory buildings and in-ground pool. Or did your motion
I specifically noted it's just the cabana.
Okay.
It's just the cabana.
Okay.
It's in question. In fact, when I write this up,
okay,
one way or the other, I will note that the swimming pool, based on Glenn's memorandum of such and such date, is not an issue with this meeting.
Do we need to make a finding that, based upon the further revised plans and the opinion of the building inspector, that the pool is excluded from the variance application because it conforms to the setbacks? Just to be in keeping with with the notice.
Wouldn't hurt.
You could refer to it conforms to the requirements of 5.5.1.7. I think it's 1F rather.
Yeah.
Something
yeah.
Like
so
that.
Maybe we'd also
could
make
do
a required
either
finding.
Either
so.
Yeah, if you think we need a finding, David,
yeah,
like we could do it
that
to way.
Be,
or,
to be
or
safe.
As I says.
Right.
I think it's.
Or as I had noted, we could just make reference in the written decision that the in-ground pool, based on Glenn's memorandum,
okay,
is a non-issue.
All right. We have a motion. We have a second. Before we put it to a vote, we're a five-member board, and so in order for you for the motion to carry, you need 4 out of 5 members to vote in your favor.
Okay.
Just thought I'd bring that to your attention. Any further discussion on the motion on the table?
No. And you understand if the motion does not carry, then.
Yes.
You would most likely have to go back to Glenn and then get a building permit and relocate the cabana there.
Yep.
Okay. Yep.
All right. Hearing no further discussion, we'll take a vote. All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? Motion carries 4-1. Bear with me for 1 second. I'll get you a stamp plan. Thank you. all we're making reference to is just the plot plan. So that's all I'll stand
right.
for.
Right.
So the board will write up your decision. It'll be available in the clerk's office probably 30 or so days after the appeal period runs.
Okay.
So you might just keep in touch with Kim perhaps, and
sure.
she'll give you a heads up as to when and whether it's ready for you to pick up.
You'll
need this to be attached to the decision and recorded with your variance.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Folks in the audience, if you're here tonight for our hearings, if you wouldn't mind signing in at the front, on the front little table there, so that the town knows that you're here and we can record your attendance at the hearing. Thank you. Thanks again for reminding me.
Okay. I'll take care of that one, David.
Sorry?
I'll take care of that one.
Okay, yes, thank
yep.
you. All right, the next case on our agenda tonight is case number 1618. We'll go ahead and read the public notice. Public hearing on the application by O'Bradley Latham Esquire on behalf of Arbor Green Inc. pursuant to Mass General Laws Chapter 48, Section 6 for variances and such other relief the board deems necessary under Section 6.3 of the zoning bylaw to allow the use of the property located at 90-92 Green Street, Reading, Massachusetts, as a four-family dwelling. Again, unless there's any objection, I'll dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as were the appropriate boards and committees in town and public safety, members and associate members of the Board of Appeals, as well as the planning boards of the surrounding communities. Testimony given before this board is taken under oath, so if you think you're gonna speak to this application, please stand and raise your right hand. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and the response is I do.
Thank you.
Attorney Latham, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So my name is Brad Latham. I'm the attorney for the applicant. Tom Bergendahl, who is the owner of the property at Auburn Green, is with me this evening, as well as Matt Landis, who is the engineer, the architect. The property is 90-92 Green Street. It's located at the northwestern corner of the intersection of Green and Elliott. The land area is 12,368 square feet, and the lot and the building predate. There is currently a three-story dwelling on the property, wood frame, built about 1920. The building contains five apartments, one of which is vacant. It's located in the 840 district, so the use is a permissible use. That's not a non-conforming feature here. The case deals with dimensional request variances, not use variances. There's the lot area, the front yard setback, and the rear yard setback are non-conforming. The building itself is about 7 feet from Green Street. The garage behind the building is less than 3 feet from the rear lot line. The garage is not usable. All the parking that is done either on the property itself openly or on the street. The building needs significant structural upgrades, restoration and renovation of the property. The applicant would like to tear down the existing structure and get a new structure. Building that should provide is a big arc, and by allowing that sort of relief, it'd be a safer, more usable, more attractive structure on the lot. The building would be significantly lower in height than the existing building. Each unit would have its own garage. It would be attractively landscaped. With reference to parking, the zoning requires 1.5 parking spaces for each unit in the apartment. That means 6 in total are required. The plan that was presented with the application shows 4 garages, so that would be 4, and then 2 get on the driveway off of Elliott Street for a total of six. Having said that, it is very possible to put a surface driveway also on the side of the new building to add additional parking. Another approach would be to move the structure back farther than 7 feet from Green Street, another 10 feet, and you'd be able to have additional parking in front of each garage. And Tom is open to that. The hope here tonight is to open some dialogue and to respond to concerns that the board may have. And if relocating the building on the lot is one of those, he's most amenable to do that, and that might be able to establish more parking and more room in front of the driveway themselves. Because it doesn't conform to the dimensional requirements, we need to ask for relief. One of those is the lot size itself. The lot is going to change that. It is what it is, and that's not going to be a change in feature. It's still going to serve as four units on the same lot. As to setbacks, the front yard and the rear yard setback do not conform. Right now, the building is 7 feet from the front lot line, and the required setback is 30 feet. The rear yard with the garage that exists is about 3 feet, which should be removed. And the proposal is to put the building would be a little over 26 feet. So that's a variance of about 4 feet on the rear lot line. Lot coverage is an issue that we need to deal with. The maximum coverage in the 840 district is 25%. The relief requested is to exceed that by 7.3%. In other words, they have lot coverage allowed of 32.3%. The last item that we need to discuss or request relief on is the gross floor area. That's a unique measurement for the apartment district. And it says that the gross floor area of a multifamily dwelling shall not exceed 40% of the lot area. Right now it's about 40%. It would be 45% lot coverage if relief is granted, a variance of 5% of the lot coverage. So with reference to the elements and the relief requested, I'd like to start through them, if I may, and then I'm going to ask Matt to step in during this presentation to give particulars of the various items. As you know, the statute gives a basis for uniqueness that it can relate to the land or to the structure. In this case, the relief, the need for relief relates to the structure itself. And as Matt is going to describe, the structure is in a difficult condition. It's located too close to Green Street. So at this point, I'm going to ask if Matt would step up and describe the structure itself, the use, and the hardship that would be involved in trying to make the property conform the current life safety codes and other related issues.
My name is Matt Landis. I work with Peter Sandoz at Phoenix Architects. We've been working with Tom for the past year or so to try to get a new proposal for this building to have a smaller presence on the area, but also have a smaller roof line, try to bring some of that down and to tie some of the character in the rest of the neighborhood. But what we've also been working on is some of what Brad mentioned is examining the existing conditions of the property that stands there now. So the majority of the interior changes are some of the photos up top. A significant amount of work inside. Every stairway needs to be brought up to code. All these stairways are about 32 inches, so they all need to be 42 inches in order to be considered egress. Other means of egress also need to be added to this as well. For the exterior of the building, there's a significant amount of damage. This exterior foundation wall here is actually leaning towards the back of the property. So this entire back wall has this bow in it. And my guess is that the weight of the gable, the sizing of the rafters and the ceiling joists and the gable are actually not sized adequately. So that wall is starting to buckle, which I think is transferring all the way down that exterior wall and is doing the same amount of damage in the foundation as well. There's a good amount of rot and water damage around the property, so that gets covered over by rubber roofs or similar types of small fixes. There's also some buckling in the roof. So, you know, we went through, we tried to try to get a better sense of how much of the building we would need to touch in order to bring it up to code, and I think it's close to about 100%. So the back wall's leaning, the roof shows some serious signs of buckling, rot, and deterioration, but I think if we go through, we do this alteration, it becomes an alteration level 3, which is altering more than 50% of the entire structure. So that means that unless we use foam insulation, which for this project would be close to about $80,000, all of the exterior walls, which are 2x4 in this case, all need to be swapped out for 2x6 walls. All the floors are 2x8, so those all need to be upsized because the codes have changed since 1920. Even if everything is repaired to its pre-damaged state, it still doesn't meet the adequate egress and life safety requirements that are today's codes. So by the time we fix everything, to be honest with you, I think we'll be ripping down pretty much to the foundation wall as it stands today. So what we're asking, what we're hoping to accomplish is to start fresh and to start with a brand new foundation, to make it adequately sized, to use stronger bracing and shear walls in the exterior wall to shore some of that up and make sure that some of the energy requirements of the compliance of today's standards, energy appliance in the windows that we use, the insulation that we use, and to make sure that this building, again, it becomes structurally sound. I think that's one of the most important things. And from these photos and from some of our site visits and analysis, there's signs of rot in some of the basement beams. There's holes dug from either termites or some other kind of beetle. So it has a significant amount of damage, and we're trying to... With projects like this too, a couple times what we did is we lift the entire project, the entire building up, we move it back about 100 feet, tear out the whole foundation, and pour a whole new foundation and put it back on. And that works out fantastic sometimes, but I'm worried that with this, the way the structural integrity of that wall as it stands today, I'm worried that if we actually move that, I don't think it's going to hold up. So I think there's a significant amount of damage done to the building, and I think it would take pretty much ripping it down to the studs in the foundation in order to bring it up back to today's codes, not even including the amount of life safety and egress issues that we would be needing to address moving forward to bring it to 2016 as well.
In the past, this board has considered economic practicality or impracticality of trying to renovate property as a basis for hardship. We hope you come to that same conclusion in this case. And I'm referring to Frankie, the property right across the street that was done. That's not in the 840 district. That's a 4-family that was rebuilt. I think that's an attractive addition to the neighborhood. Also one on Washington Street. And both of those are similar cases where you have reached that conclusion. Would also like to suggest that allowing this would not be substantial detrimental to the neighborhood or to the public good. The new building, as you have seen here, is attractive. It's only about 29 feet high, so it's a much better scale.
That's the same one we have?
That's what we have. And I believe that an attractive structure of that nature with landscaping and so forth would not be detrimental. We don't think of a derogation from the intent and purpose of the zoning bylaw. Just because of the unique features that are involved here, that this is being done to try and meet the life safety codes. As a matter of fact, I started the presentation, I said this is a 5-unit building, and the assessors categorize it as that as well. Glenn has stopped the first floor from being used, even though it's been there for years, because of the fact that it doesn't have a second means of access. You just can't do it under the current circumstances. So basically, those are the facts and the presentation. We're more than happy to answer any questions that the board may have. Thank you.
Thanks, Fred. We'll open up the matter to comments from board members. And Robert, if you'd like to start us off in that regard.
Sure. First question, is this going to be sold as townhouse units or are they going to be rental units?
I'm hoping to do it as townhouse units. The only
townhouse.
Right. Yeah. The only hesitancy I have there is I think we're right on the edge of a market correction in terms of real estate. And if there's a correction and real estate takes a dive again like it did in 2007, 2008, I may have to hold on to that as rental property until I can sell it, put it on the market as condos.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you're talking, yeah, four units as opposed to what there is now, and I saw in the assessor's documentation stuff, it is considered a five-unit.
Correct.
Rental right now, apartment, correct?
Okay.
And it looked to me, I see the, yet I got confused here with the shed in the back. It looks like you're retaining that shed. Are you not? You
in the left-hand corner?
Yeah, in the left-hand corner, I see, you know, you here's the proposed conditions, and it shows the shed there, but
you
yet... You talked about in there, in your variances,
the
that the garage is 3 or 4 feet, and you're going to be, you say that's going to be taken away, that nonconformance,
right.
And you're asking actually a variance of for the 26.9 feet.
Yes.
Because what's required, I believe, is what, 30 feet?
30.
30 feet, yeah. So that shed is going to be removed then.
That's fine with me. I mean, that's... I don't think it adds a whole lot of value if each unit has its own garage.
Yeah,
I
was going to say, who's
no need for a shed.
Who's going to own it? Are you
going
to divide the shed
exactly,
into four four cubicles?
So I think it's kind of,
yeah,
that'll be.
Okay, yeah, but I see where you may keep it there during construction or something for use to store things or construction materials, but okay. And going through here, in your arguments, Brad, listening to that, let's go to argument three there. And I know you didn't say too much about it, but it's noted here.
I thought if I may give you a brief that maybe updated to what
okay.
you saw with the application. It's very similar, but some of the arguments are a little
yeah, because I know in the arguments that we got, the front yard setback will be rendered more conforming. It appears to me that you're keeping it the same.
That's correct.
Yeah. So
the earlier, you may or may not recall, we had never reached you. We had an application that had the building in a different location. This application has left it consistent with the current plan.
Mm-hmm.
Tom is prepared to do either one. He's prepared to leave it 7 feet, consistent with the way it is now. We'll move it back 10 feet if that's the preference of this board.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let me just, so the basically the other arguments we had with our packet then are superseded by these new
the document I just gave
documentation
consistent
yeah.
with the arguments
yeah.
I made tonight.
Okay, let me okay. And other than that, no, I think it would be an improvement to the neighborhood, and it certainly going by the house, it looked like it was in need of some maintenance on that. I think you're, you know, one of the things I'm going to be looking at as we get deeper into this, and again, it you get into the relief, and it's the hardship sometimes. Is a problem, and I look and you noted that they where did I see this before here, and the bylaw would involve enforcement of the bylaw. Little enforcement would involve substantial hardship, and that word substantial is I think that's what that all hinges on. Might involve some hardship, but what is it's you know the definition of substantial or not. I don't know.
That's, well, we were hopeful that some of Matt's testimony would show the significance of what is going to have to be done to make this conform to code.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, that's all I have right now, David. Thank you.
Thanks, Robert. John?
I'll probably start with the four units versus the five units. Do you have any history when the house was built? It's 90 and 92 Green Street. Like a unit on 90 and another unit on 92. I don't see too many other residences in the town that have two numbers for their existence. I wondered back in the 20s when this was built, was it built as two different homes on two different lots?
I don't know. I think that what the town used to do is to allocate a certain amount of space to the street numbers. And I don't know what the philosophy was in 1920, if they look at the width of a lot and assign two numbers to it or not. I think the main issue, but we know they're concerned about the history of use because of the non-conforming nature of the use.
Right.
Here we're in an 840 district, so we didn't look at that.
It would appear to me, John, I don't know if I could interject, it looks like it was maybe built as a two-family house, and that's why you have the 90 and the 92. Looks like it was maybe originally built with entrances on either side, one being number 90, one being number 92. You see a number of that on Woburn
yeah.
Street in the older, if you go up there, the two families, and I think mm-hmm. Prescott Street.
Washington Street. Too.
Washington Street.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that was the first issue. I know that I guess Kim could reinforce. We don't keep records anymore. when you're putting your categorizing or digitizing the records that
oh,
we have.
Oh, scanning them into LaserFiche.
Right.
No, we're keeping the records. We're keeping the building jackets.
The jackets, yes.
Yes.
But not necessarily. That doesn't give us the complete history of.
Whatever has been there 20 years ago is still in that jacket.
Oh, okay, okay. So that was question number one. Question number two, I look at this and in connection with what the building inspector had sent out as his emails, being on the board as long as I have, there's always a question of which came first, the horse or the cart. And in a situation like this, it has to go to site plan review again, or has to go to site review for a number of issues, several issues, which may increase the number of waivers that you may be requesting under the variance issues down the line. Parking certainly could be one of the big ones. But there's others that are coming forth, such as the lot size and all the rest of it that you have mentioned today. And I see that on the brief that you just gave us, and what you had mentioned was that there's a 45% gross floor area, yet on the plan it shows it as 51%. I'm not talking about I guess I'm looking at all of these issues that's coming before us in this proposal that we have here in front of us this evening, and I see just a large number of issues that have to be resolved that's going to be done in site plan review before it comes back before this board. The issue of it, should it stay at 7 feet from Green Street, or should it be moved back to at least 10 feet on Green Street? I mean, all of that is going to be, you're parking in front of the garage of each of the units and picking up additional parking space as well. 7 feet in front of the garage is not sufficient unless you're going to get a smart car as your second vehicle. So that becomes an issue, and that's down the line with site plan review. There's a number of others that are addressed under site plan review, which is were listed as landscape requirements, 4.6, 4.62, and 9.0, which is the parking requirement. I don't know if that includes a loading zone because it's a multi-family now, more than two or three. I don't know where we're going, so my question is, are we a little premature in trying to put the cart before the horse, or the horse before the cart, or where exactly we stand?
I suggest we have the horse in front of the cart by doing this way. And I know we have this discussion in other cases, but I think that we have to know whether we can do this in the first place to then refine it. And our site plan is exterior refinement. Beautification, exterior lighting. The location of the building on the lot is up to you. If you tell us whether we can have a variance for the rear yard, the front yard, and if so, how much. So we have to start there. As I suggested in the conclusion of my brief, if you were to grant relief, you can impose alternative conditions. One condition could be we have to go to site plan review, which we have to do anyway. Second condition could be that after we've gone through that, we have to come back to you for your blessing on those features. But we really need to know that we can do it in the first place to then make it worthwhile to go to all these other issues.
Well, I then go back to we're asking for relief on maximum lot coverage. We're going from 25% to 32%. The front setback requirement, the side setback requirement, the rear setback requirement, all issues that we have to do. This is brand new construction. The board in the past has, I would say, not look favorably on new construction for these large number of reliefs before the construction is done. I think the biggest one of the, to me, are the dimensional controls and the lot coverage. You're taking what is now just a smaller structure, and you're basically increasing the size of the structure on the lot to virtually twice the size. I know it doesn't show it in the 30, from the 25 to the 32, but in actuality, in a form of appearances and actual area along Green Street, you actually are. So my questions right now are relative to, are we moving too quickly to say that we can knock down a one structure which has a particular air coverage of the 25, meets the 25, actually less than the 25%, and go to something that's almost twice the size. And I don't know what that would do to the neighborhood. To me, I can't quite picture it yet, even though there is another one on the other side of the street, which was tastefully done, but it wasn't as expansive as this proposal appears to be. So I'll just stop there because I don't have enough of the quantifications yet in my mind.
Okay, John. Cy.
Well, I still have a little confusion too about cart for the horse and all that kind of stuff too, but just looking at it from a broader perspective, what you want to do here compared to what you have now, you're not creating, at the moment at least, a new nonconformity as far as rear setback is concerned. You're not creating a new nonconformity as far as front setback is concerned. You are improving side setback with this new plan. And you're taking a big chunk out of gross floor area, the size of the facility. I mean, that's the biggest change I see here that's going on. It would seem to me that one of the suggestions I would make would be that you need to really address your ability or capability to provide adequate parking to get closer to what the zoning bylaw requires. And that would suggest that you got to move the building back. It's going to create a new rear setback issue by so doing. It's going to improve your front setback issue, you know. But the relief you're looking for really doesn't change by doing that, okay? But it would seem to me, as someone looking at this, that I would look better on it if it was further back on the property, okay? I still have a hang up of which comes first, whether we act on something here tonight, subject to site plan review, da 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 da. That's something I think we need to discuss a little more. That's all.
Thanks, Sly. Nick?
I'm just going to say my opinion is I think it would have to go before us first to see if we could even allow the use and then go to site plan review to kind of look at what we allow and regulate that and look at, you know, impose conditions on that. I did have a question for the applicant, though. It's a five-unit building right now. Why are you going to 4 units and not trying to maintain 5 units? And I ask that because is there something about the shape or the topography or the size of the lot that's influencing that decision?
Well, I think that the objective was to try and find a change that would be perhaps more attractive to the permit granting authority, to not try and put too much on the lot. We realize it has to show respect for side yard requirements for coverage, and if in fact another unit were added, we'd end up with more land coverage. So the idea is to try and be respectful of the scale, and that's why they abandoned 5 and went to 4.
I can also speak to that as well. I think if we added another unit in order to maintain a similar footprint, I think by the time we took the amount of space out of each bedroom, they would essentially not be as comfortable or as usable as they are with a 4-unit building. So if we have a little bit more space with a 4-unit building, it makes some of the rooms a bit larger. But I think if we add that fifth, it might cram everything a bit too much.
Is that? And I'm going to start my comments by reading into the record the notes that we have from the building inspector, and that'll sort of start off my comments as well. And so Glenn writes, for case 1618 at 90-92 Green Street in an A40 district, this building permit application is to demolish the existing multifamily and to construct a new 4-family structure. The following issues must be addressed. A site plan review is required under section 4.6 and 4.6.2, landscape standards under section 6.5, parking requirements under 9.0, lot area and coverage, front setback and rear setback. So those are the comments that Glenn has. I'm of the opinion that for the most part, the issues before this board today relate primarily to the last three on that list: lot area and coverage, front setback, and rear setback. I think we ought to address parking as well, as that does in some respects come under our purview, but the top two in that area are part of the site plan review process, and anything that we set out here today will be subject to the site plan review as well, and they may need to tweak that as part of site plan review. I know we often have the chicken and the egg discussion regarding site plan review, but I'm of the opinion right now that site plan review is probably not even necessary unless they know that a variance can be granted so that they can do anything regarding the lot area and coverage setback and the setback issues. So I'm of the opinion that they've asked us for relief today, and we ought to consider those areas that we feel are, as a board, are relevant to the application for a variance as they relate to, I guess, particularly the lot area and coverage, front and rear setbacks, and I think size point is well taken regarding the parking. I have those concerns as well. How many total bedrooms is the new structure intended to be?
It's 12, yep, 3 per unit.
12, okay.
12.
And so, you know, I'm of the same opinion with Cy that given the attention and necessity and the importance of not impacting the public parking areas in town any further, that we ought to think about whether or not the parking requirements need to be conditioned and or whether or not the applicant wants to give some consideration to coming back with a proposal that perhaps is a little bit more in line with the town's 1.5 spots requirement. Secondarily, you know, Brad pointed out that we've, as a board, in its various incarnations, has address issues related to the condition of multifamily structures in considering variance applications. Excuse me. And I think that the distinction that the board has made, and as recently as one of our recent hearings, is that we make a distinction between serious public safety, health, and conditional issues. I think like we did on Washington Street, that building was, I think, falling down, if I recall correctly. And issues that might be considered age, wear and tear, and perhaps deferred maintenance. And again, the applicant, you're the current owner of this building?
Yes.
Okay. And so it's not as if you're buying it from somebody and you're trying to figure out what you can do with it before you can...
Correct.
Okay. So, you know, Brad's right in that we really don't have any guidance from the courts in Massachusetts on how to relate the first criteria to structures. And, you know, that crosses a line, in my opinion, regarding whether or not, you know, we're dealing with a use versus the lot. Because the location of the building on the lot is really, I think, what we're dealing with as a board in here. In the setbacks, lot in the lot coverage issue, and so, you know, I've got an issue with the lot coverage. You know, it's in my view a significant increase. I understand that, given some of the dimensional changes that you're making, you're reducing some of the encroachments into the setbacks, and I applaud that. You know, the lot coverage issue is perhaps an issue for me as I sit here today. And certainly, I think I've already said it, I won't beat it, but parking is an issue as well. And I'll close my comments with that. And I will, I don't know, Brad, does the applicant want to address anything about what I've said, or would you like me to just open up to public comment?
I think public comment if we could, and we can
very well
speak thereafter.
All right, so the board has had an opportunity to comment and ask questions. At this time, if there are any members of the audience that would like to speak to this application, please make yourself known, give your name and address, rise, and be heard. Hearing none from members of the public, we will close the public comment portion of our hearing. Are there any other comments or questions from the board at this time?
You made a comment about parking being 1.5 spaces. If I go to section 9 for townhouses, townhouse development says 2 spaces per dwelling is the minimum number. And there's no requirement for loading and unloading spaces required per this.
If I may, perhaps you can go through this. I know zoning's been a moving target in Reading for these last couple of years, so.
Yeah, you got it.
Can you refer me to the section you're referring to? I just wanted to touch this.
I'm referring to the table under 9117, page 79.
Page 79, okay.
Yeah. This has to do with off-street loading.
I think townhouse and townhouse development is a separate, isn't that a separate process as opposed to what we're talking about here? Or is that intended to be any townhouse?
Well, that's a good question.
Because it talks about apartments, and this is defined as an apartment dwelling by the zoning. I will say this, though, as I said at the beginning, to the extent you want to see changes made to the parking capacity, Tom wants to do that. He wants to satisfy concerns.
Yeah.
So I'm not trying to...
Well, the ability to comply with that is, if you move the building back, is not too complicated.
I agree.
Okay.
More than happy to
so,
do that.
I mean, it's a moot question,
sure.
Maybe. Okay.
What's the size of the garages on this? Are these single-car garages or double?
They're single-car.
Same, look like single.
Single, yeah. That's what it looks like. And obviously, I think you brought up a good point, John, and Cy did on the parking there. Certainly... That one garage that's 7 feet from the street line seems inadequate to stack a car in that lot, certainly.
That's agreed.
And
absolutely.
Yeah.
The building has to go back 10, 11 feet,
yeah.
I believe, to have that parking in front count as an issue.
Yeah, because I think you're going to need that. And I think we saw that on Washington Street, too, even though they had garages, and you go by there today, the people, whether they're using the garages for storage or what, but most of them are, have two cars in that driveway. And as you know, come November in Reading, there's no on-street parking, overnight on-street parking. So consequently, the cars should be in at least one car, and most of these most likely would have two cars per unit. Would have to have one in the driveway, one in the garage then, on that, so.
Should I ask you a question, Mr. Chairman? If in fact, there's an indication that as to the elements of a variance, the board might be satisfied, then it would make sense for Tom to go back and move the building, come back with a different site plan that shows two spaces in front, or you could actually do it by the condition of your decision, whichever you want to do. That's something we certainly could do.
Well, that gets a little bit into like an advisory opinion,
yeah.
which the board doesn't give, or is loath to give, and has never, as long as I've been on it. I guess one of the things that I'm thinking about, I mean, the plans would need to be revised before we would be able to grant
any relief.
Any
yeah.
relief. Mm-hmm. And in that regard, while, you know, I don't know how the board is leaning, and if you want us to take a vote on what's been presented, I'm pretty sure you don't. But if you want us to take a vote on what's been presented, that's what we're here for. But we'd have a tough time voting without a complete record, I think. If the applicant has heard what the board has had to say from commentary and questions, I think the applicant might be served by revamping a few things and coming back.
Mr. Chairman, we do hear this loud and clear. We request a continuance of 2 weeks to be able to present back to you a plan that we think addresses more completely the concerns out there tonight.
All right.
Do we want to list some of those concerns, or do we have a clarification?
Brad's been taking copious notes, but certainly if we want to...
Parking certainly is it sounds like the big issue.
Well, I think also that David brought it up. I brought it up too. And that was the coverage of the floor, the gross floor area increase up to 32%. This is brand new construction. I think that's a substantial increase in terms of the size of the structure. I know you're going for three bedroom units. You're trying to maximize what you're trying to get off the property. I don't know how that would play out, but by reducing the size of the structure or the resulting structure, including the four units, that might also help us not only from the front setback requirement, but also from the rear yard setback, which you're asking for relief from too. So I certainly, if we were gonna make a list beside the parking, I would like to see something somewhat smaller in terms of scope.
If possible.
If possible, yeah. I mean, I'm not telling you have to do that.
I think that's possible because, I mean, just going through from from an architectural standpoint, if we take 6 inches basically out of every single room, the entire building shifts by about 3 feet. So we know that times two, we can get that back. Also, the depth of the garages can change to more of an apartment style. I mean, I think they're about 24 feet right now, and with the setbacks and with some of the changes, I'm pretty confident we can decrease that number without sacrificing.
So that's the depth of the garage is 24 feet.
Right, so I think that we can start decreasing some of those numbers without affecting the number of units or, you know, the number of apartments as well.
Why did you make it 24 feet? That's pretty good size.
It's a typical depth for a garage is about 12 by 24. The usual two-car garage is 24 by 24. So it's the typical sizes that we try to go off, and if we need to adjust the shift.
Is there going to be... what type of foundation work on this? Slab on grade, or is it going to, are they going to have basements to these units?
That's a good question.
Because that's what I say, I look at the garage, and a large garage like that would be needed most likely if it was slab on grade for storage.
Yeah.
But if they do have basements,
yeah.
it can, you know, the basements are used for storage.
Yeah.
That's where a lot of your heating equipment can go.
Yeah. And you're talking about the structure being 29 feet high. What's the height of the area inside the garage also? I mean, if we're talking about, you know, 8 feet versus 9 or 10 feet,
yeah,
that makes a big difference, too, in terms of storage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So,
I think
whether full basements or whether slabs or crawl space, I don't know.
I think the flavor of the conversation is if you can do anything to bite into the size, it's a step in the right direction. That's all.
All right, the applicant has, I think, a good flavor as to where the board's comments lie, has requested a continuance, and I guess before we make a motion to continue, we ought to think about when we've got a tough couple of few weeks, and even the month of November is
like the next open date, David,
so
is December 15th.
December 15th, according to the calendar I have, or the open dates I have in front of me. Does that give the applicant enough time to do what he needs to do to come back? All right, I'd entertain a motion from a board member to continue to December 15th. Then.
I move we continue this case to December 15th, did we say?
Mm-hmm. December 15th is the next open date we have.
Where do we, tentatively, we're on board for the 10th of November on the
14th? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's the deadline date, too.
I know, and that's what I'm
and
saying.
That's probably when we have to close the hearing on that date now.
Or get an extension.
Well, which is not guaranteed. We've got a 40B project in town, and right now the deadline for closing the hearing is December 15th by agreement. So that would affect, if we are to leave, typically we would meet again in December, but because of town meeting, town staff has asked us to cancel what would normally be a December 1 zoning board hearing in case town meeting spills over. There's likely to be there could be some spillover from what's going to start in the middle of November. May spill over. I don't know that it will, but they've already canceled that. So I think we're so that we don't have to give you a date and then take it away from you, would you consider coming back January 5th, 2017?
Sure.
Yes. Okay. All right. why don't we make a motion to continue them to January 5th, just so that we leave that December 15th date open?
Well, I modify the motion to continue this hearing on case 16-18 until January 5th, 2017.
I'll second what you want.
Okay. No, that's fine, Joe.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Thank you for your time.
None opposed. 500 carries. We're continued to January 5th of 2017 at 7 p.m. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Need to write up a little note on that, right?
No.
No, nothing?
Not necessary.
Okay.
Write up and continue.
Okay.
Good catch.
Yeah.
I was coming down the road.
Yeah, no, good,
right.
Good catch. We're gonna need that date, December 15th. On our agenda tonight, thank you for being patient, is case 16-20. Go ahead and read the legal notice. Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing in the Selectman's Meeting Room at Town Hall on Thursday, November 3rd, 2016 at 7 p.m. on the petition of MJP Properties, Inc., who seek a variance under Section 6.3 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct an open deck 10 feet by 12 feet as per plan with an 11.3 foot side yard setback rather than the required 15 foot setback on the property located at 43 Track Road in Reading, Massachusetts. Unless there's an objection, I'll dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as were the appropriate boards and committees and public safety in town, members and associate members of the Board of Appeals, as well as the planning boards of abutting communities. Testimony before this board is taken under oath, so if you think you're going to speak on this case, please stand and raise your right hand and be sworn. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The response is I do. All right, we'll leave it to the applicant.
Good evening. My name is Michael Page from Griffin Engineering. I represent MJP Properties, Michael Panzero. The petitioner is seeking a variance from the bylaw granting permission to construct a 10 by 12 wooden deck to a recently constructed dwelling, on the construction dwelling at 43 Track Road, which will encroach in the rear yard setback. I think during your reading of the, you said it was 15 foot rear setback. I actually think it's a 20 foot rear setback in this district. But anyway, just a...
Might be an error in the notice.
Well, it's because I think it's a corner lot.
Yeah, it could be
it
a rear or side.
The building inspector notes it, I think.
So he might be calling it a...
When I spoke with Glenn originally, when we got the building permitted, he told me that that was considered a rear yard setback, and this is going to be considered a front yard, and this section on Harvest Road was considered a side yard.
Yeah, okay,
so
that's what we ran into the last meeting.
Yeah.
There.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So it should be a 20, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify that. Okay, so the petitioner voluntarily demolished a dimensional non-conforming residence shown here in light gray. The residence was needed substantial repair. He constructed a new conforming single-family residence, which is shown here. The setbacks are shown here, the dotted lines, showing that the new footprint fit appropriately in the it met dimensional requirements or zoning dimensional requirements for setbacks. The existing parcel is a non-conforming lot, though, for the S15 district. The parcel itself has 6,133 square feet, which is 15,000 required. And the frontage is 73.17 feet, and where 100 feet is required. The recently demolished non-conforming residence had a rear yard setback of 1.1 feet, and had a side yard setback of 10.9 feet. So it was well into the rear yard and into the side yard. The new deck will have 11.3 rear yard setback. When we first permitted the new dwelling, we determined what type of footprint and where to position the property, the footprint on the site, in order to make it a conforming to the zoning bylaw for dimensions. And for max coverage, we're only increasing it by approximately 1%. We're still meeting the max coverage percentage for a lot. So the only issue we have on site is the rear yard setback for the deck. We believe granting the request is justified based on hardships in the neighborhood. The hardships is substandard lot size relative to the zoning district and the narrow width of the lot along Track Road and Harvest Road. The house now under construction with the proposed deck is more consistent with the character of the majority of the neighborhood than the recently demolished residence. The new constructed building is slightly larger. As you can see, it's only 1%, so it's not wasn't too much bigger. It was we stayed conservative when we were in the setbacks. But I think that's it for now. Any questions? Open it up.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
I will go through the normal routine and ask for board comments and questions. We'll start with Nixon this time.
Okay, how tall is the deck? Because I noticed on the plans there's substantially way more stairs than the front steps.
The deck will be approximately 8 feet above the grade.
And how does that relate to the topography in the back? Why is it so high?
The house itself is sticking up out of the, I don't know if you guys swung by there or not, but the house itself is up high. So the lot itself is relatively flat. So when the house was constructed, it was constructed a little bit, it was constructed up high so we could have a garage under. So the house was brought up higher, and so fill was brought in along, well, fill not fill, but the excavated material from the footprint was placed along the side and front, and the back was left lower. Almost, isn't it a walkout basement, or is it?
Yeah, it's pretty much a walkout basement.
Walkout basement back there.
And on the right side, they used to have the other garage, the other driveway. And the where the deck is proposed to go, that's just the grade, the prior grade. So that's why it looks higher. And on the other mound, in the front stairs where you're seeing, is where we had to get the 4 foot coverage for the basement. So you had to get 4 foot coverage, so the stairs on the front of the house are here, higher, which I'm coming in from the side, which makes the grade less than what you see from the street. The stairs face out to the street, but we're coming in from the side from the driveway to take the curse away from the pitch in the front. And I'll put 3 stone stairs coming up, so the gradual walk will be decreased, the incline.
Okay. Would you identify yourself for
the
secretary?
My name is Michael Pianzaro, president of MJP Properties.
Thank you. Anything else, Nick?
That's all I had.
Okay. Si?
Down at the front part of this thing, you got a structure that goes all the way over to about 1.1 feet?
Yeah.
Huh?
Right
That's
here?
Part of the current building?
The shed here?
That shed?
No, I'm talking behind it.
Where the carport is.
Oh,
it says existing building raised. Oh, that was raised before.
That was raised
before.
Back in July 2000. That was our. That's
oh,
raised.
Okay.
The
all right.
Yes,
okay.
Structure.
That was raised.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I started to look at this thing, I says, you know, in terms of the nonconformities, I first thought you really weren't creating any new nonconformities based on what was there before.
Correct.
Okay.
Right.
Everything's getting better.
Yeah. If we anticipated the deck prior to construction, we probably would have came and requested for the deck and the house for the ZBA and prior to demolishing the
But now that
building.
That building is gone,
right.
Now you're stuck with asking for a variance.
Correct.
Yeah, I should have left it there for a while. Okay, that's the only clarification I wanted.
Yeah. John.
I have to apologize. I did not see the actual site. I looked, I missed it. I didn't go back a second time to try to find it. I found what I thought was 43 Track Road, but it was on the opposite side, the one closest to the rotary. And that was anything but new construction. So my question, I think just answered, why was this not considered in the actual construction of the...
We just didn't anticipate the... The deck itself in the back there, in the rear. We were, I think, between the addition of the sliding doors and everything with the future buyers, sort of added the deck. And prior it was just going to be a landing, but the future buyers requested that sliding door. And, so,
and
it's also, and it's,
okay.
And it's yeah, go ahead.
And the, in the, the deck you said is about 8 feet off the ground. Where is that in terms of, I should say, where's the deck in terms of the rooms within the structure, within the house, home?
I see what you're saying. What
is that
room
opening
is
off
the
of the kitchen? Is
the
that
kitchen.
It's off the kitchen, sir. You come in.
What?
You have the sliders. On your left of the sliders is an island, a peninsula, and your kitchen is running on that wall. So those sliders open up, that's your entranceway out from the to the ground. So that's why the deck, you come out of the sliders are 5 foot. So if you just put the landing, it's not going to cover the length of the sliders coming in. So when you're coming out of your sliders, you're basically in a 4 foot, 3.5 foot landing. Instead of having a landing coming down with stairs, coming in right into the grade of the driveway, into the backyard. So you have your kitchen running from this wall out, sliders here, and then you go into your living room over on this side. So the sliders are pretty...
Sliders to the deck.
It's a pretty nice feature to have them right where they are. If not, it was, I think on the plan, it might have had a door leading out of there. maybe it wasn't done correctly at first, because a door right there would have looked totally way out of place. So at the end of the day, that's why we're here, to make it right and make it look right.
Well, what's the possibility of moving that deck forward towards the immediate abutter, which would grant you a lesser encroachment on the side
itself?
That's the rear
side. This side this way.
Yeah.
I think
that's what I was wondering. You know, where is that slot? Where is that deck in relation?
We tried everything. We measured it. I personally measured it. It's not going to conform the way you think, because that's what, if you bring it back to the rear, you're into the kitchen now. Because that's where your kitchen,
plumbing, it's everything.
That's where everything is. You got a bathroom on the left corner over here. Your washer and dryer's on that side, which it doesn't matter. And that wall running to those sliders are your kitchen. So you're not going to be able to move that, because you'll just, your kitchen will never lay out. You could never lay your kitchen out if you move that backwards.
Are you telling me the kitchen's already laid out?
The plumbing and everything. We're in the stages of doing the blue board in the plaster at this point.
I'll tell you, over the years, on new construction, we don't even have what you have laid out thus far. Why it took so much time to come in to do this, I know the buyer wanted a deck out there, but the whole thing is, it's if it were existing for, I don't know, 10, 20, 30 years, or even before zoning, we can't do anything about it. But new construction, you can always readjust to do some of that stuff. And we don't even have from you the layout, I mean dimensional layouts of the inside of the structure, so that we can see that that's a necessity. I mean, I don't know where you are in terms of completion of the structure. I mean, would you say, you said you're just about the blue board the kitchen area, which means the rough plumbing is in.
All the sign-offs are complete.
Okay, I'll stop right there.
Thanks, Robert.
Yeah, again, like John, it's difficult with new construction looking at issues like this. I went out, I did find the property and was able to take a look at it. It is tricky to find if you're not used to the area. It's on the, if you're out there, it's on the north side of the stream that runs through that, you might say that residential area or that neighborhood.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a stream there. It's on the north side. I think you went to the south side.
I did,
John, yeah. Mm-hmm. But beside the point, it is, and when I went out and looked and I noticed, the deck's gonna have to be up very high, 8 feet you said, because that's where the slider is. I think the slider's in already up there, yeah. And if you're gonna access outside, which I assume it's a secondary access that you'd wanna be able to get outside.
Absolutely.
From up there.
Second means of egress.
Yeah, though I think somebody could, I don't know if you could consider the basement, because he just noted it's a walkout basement. Probably the door's under the deck. For the walkout basement?
It could be a walkout basement. It's not a walkout.
Oh, it's not out yet. Right. It's
yeah,
not a walkout yet.
You can go up to the garage.
You can go out through the garage. There's a door in the front of the garage. And you see the garage door.
That's the way you would do it then.
And you see the garage. There's
okay.
A door right on the left.
Okay. So there's no access under the proposed deck.
Correct.
When I went out there and I looked at it, and I know we run into this a lot with abutters, a concern with privacy, because you now there is a big differential between the abutter's property, which is to the rear, and you, as you noted, you're supposed to be 20 feet away now, though the request was originally 15 feet, and you're 11 feet from that. And there's I'm going to say it's a 6-foot white vinyl fence that runs all along that rear property. They're going to be overlooking. They're 2 feet higher than that vinyl fence, overlooking that property.
I have a letter from two of the abutters signed that they have no problem.
Yeah.
These guys across
well,
the street. proving that they're...
You know, in the first thing I look at this and I'm saying it's, you know, what you did is a contract. You went in and put it in the simplest deck you could find. 10 by 12 deck. We'll slap that up there. That'll keep everybody happy. You might have to do something different. I was looking at it as the 15 foot, but if you kept it 15 feet, I think you could use a trapezoid type deck. It's going to be a little longer, and you'd maybe have to go 6.5 feet to get the 15 feet where that deck is now, go 6.5 feet, and then come down about 18 feet, and you would have the deck then about 10 feet wide. So it would be more of a trapezoid, and then what you're going to do is shift the stairs to the south a bit. The stairs are going to shift 5 feet south. So, and that would not impact anything that you've done in the inside. The deck's going to be at the slider still. It's just that it wouldn't be 10 feet wide. At the slider, it would only be at one end 6.5 feet, and at the other end maybe 8 feet. And then as that deck slide southerly, it's going to widen out because the backyard, the property line, and the house are not parallel to each other. And I think that's what you're going to have to do is something like that, as opposed to just saying, well, I'll just slap a 10 by 12 deck on there and we'll use that. You maybe have to think that way.
Well, it would be more of a creative way of doing the deck.
It's creative,
which
yeah.
adds to the value of the house to begin with, because you give
I'm up for anything that works. I'm not here to...
So your question to do is 15-yard setbacks, so basically have what...
Yeah, well, at least that way, and I know now it was brought out, you're supposed to have 20, and you're asking for 11.3-foot setback where you're supposed to have 20. And I'm suggesting you maybe we can go to the 15 and give you a 5 foot, you know, maybe then you'd be questioning a 5 foot variance as opposed to almost a 10 foot variance.
Well, that would depend almost entirely on how the building inspector views that,
right.
whether it's side yard or rear yard. So
exactly.
before they would investigate whether or not a smaller deck
yeah.
with a 5 foot setback and a 15 5 foot encroachment into a 15 yard setback.
Right.
They'd want to confirm that the building inspector would view it that way.
Confirm that.
The notice did spell it out as 15 foot.
It did.
But as the applicant pointed out, if we're considering that rear yard,
it's 20.
It's 20.
Right.
So
yeah. if the building
while
inspector
that is helpful,
says,
Robert,
right.
as
if
we
the building
always
inspector
try to
said,
do.
All you need is 15 feet, and you did that. Kept the deck 15 feet and made it a kind of a trapezoid, truncated triangle there, and kept it 15 feet away from the rear property line, or that side property line, you wouldn't even have to be here. You don't need a variance then.
Well again,
predicated on the building inspector's...
That's predicated
that,
on the building
that presumes that it's 15 feet. We don't know that, they don't know that, and the building inspector hasn't been consulted yet.
Based
right?
on my... I did consult with Glenn,
well,
prior to this, and he did tell me that was the rear setback because he was considered this as a front yard.
What
right.
did Glenn
and
say
so
in his memo?
He said 15.
But
he said in his memo today,
his
David?
Memo said 20.
His memo... Which I haven't read into the record.
Yeah, he says
yeah,
20.
His memo okay. does say 20. I haven't read it into the
yeah.
to the record yet. So, if he views it as 20, then while your point is well taken and suggestion is well taken, it's predicated on recognizing that as 15, which the building inspector has not. Now I don't know if that changes or further discussion is merited, but Bob, did you have any further comments
no,
to make?
No, I mean, sometimes you have to, on some of these, and you hate to, as you say, David, in the last case, start offering suggestions to the applicant. It's up to the applicant to come up with maybe some unique solving of problems. If
we always try to be helpful and informative to
you have
applicants.
A unique lot in that it's a corner lot. The front door faces Track Road.
And that goes above and beyond what
right.
the statute requires us to do in circumstances where we're asked to grant the variance.
Right.
My commentary starts with, again, I'm going to just read Glenn's notes into the record. Excuse me. Case 16-20-43 Track Road, S15 District. The building, this building permit application is to construct an open deck, no roof over, to the dwelling that is currently under construction. The proposed setback is 11.3 feet rather than the required dimension of 20 feet. A variance from section 6.3 is required for rear yard setback. So those were Glenn's thoughts. My colleagues have focused primarily on the alternatives, the circumstances surrounding the deck. I'm going to turn a little bit to the statutory requirements and specifically the variance criteria under 40A. And the law in Massachusetts puts up an obstacle for you here a bit, in my opinion. One of the reasons why you're asking for a variance is because one of the criteria that you've addressed, one of the in support of your first criteria, one of the reasons in support of your first criteria is the lot size. Undersized lot can't be a basis for a variance, ever. It's not recognized under Massachusetts law. And again, we're trying to, and I understand what you're trying to do, I do. Not trying to rain on your parade, but you know, we're talking again here about theoretical potential here. What's the maximum potential we can get out of this lot and this land? And again, that's not a grounds for granting, for meeting the first or second or third criteria. And so, you know, it's in a regular shaped lot, but again, that's not necessarily a criteria recognized under Massachusetts law either. So my struggle, while we're dealing with the practicality of coming in under construction and trying to do the best you can with the property that you have, we're faced with, while all those suggestions that we've set forth are great, all we're really asked to do today is to determine whether or not you meet the four criteria. Whether the petition that you've presented today, that you've asked us to grant, meets the four statutory criteria, and I don't think you get there with the reasons that you've set forth under Chapter 48. And that's based upon, you know, my review of the case law and understanding of the case law. You know, we really don't get over the peculiar shape, topography, or conditions criteria, and that's the most important one, I think. And again, my opinion, reading of the law, and that's where I come down on it after my reading of the application. That's all I have to say about it for now. What I will do is open the hearing up to public comment. Is there anybody else that'd like to speak? Please identify yourself and name an address and be heard.
Sure. Matt Dulahy, 40 Torrey Street. I'm one of the abutters. So as a non-authoritative answer, I actually have a peninsula-shaped lot, so frontage on three streets, and it was determined that the rear plan of the house is the rear yard from Mr. Redman, in my case. So help me position my shed when we get to that 5-foot setback from the yard.
Must have been a good move that day.
a couple of comments in terms of the variance criteria. I think for me, part of this actually comes back to sort of the intent and purpose of the zoning ordinance, particularly 7.8 A and B, which are voluntarily demolition and reconstruction. And really this comes down to a number of choices that were made before today. If you do take a look at the plan, really the corners of the structure basically touch or are within inches of every setback, side, front, rear.
Right.
Included in that is a two-car garage with a room over it. So that would have been a great spot for a deck. Additionally, as we talked about, they brought in fill. You could play billiards in that neighborhood. It's so flat. They built that artificial hill so they could basically have a slab on grade. So now your deck's coming out on the first floor. As they did mention, there is a door currently existing on the back of the garage, so they would have access to the rear yard to enjoy the outdoor living, as they note, as the hardship. So you wouldn't be precluded without the deck from being able to use the backyard. There is access, and the foundation height in the rear yard is at grade, so it would be trivial to add a door directly below the kitchen or wherever is convenient in the basement. Trying to think of anything else. Other than that, just that the setback is not just over the rear setback. They're not asking for 1 or 2 feet. They're asking for nearly half of the setback in that rear yard. And again, if the garage had been eliminated, if the house had been parallel to the track road, you could have had additional space back there. There are a number of decisions that could have been made prior to construction and prior to today that would have prevented this. And furthermore, again, just in terms of degrading the intent of the zoning laws, the original permit, again, was, I assume, guided under 7.8. And now to introduce evidence that talks about the previous structure. So it's included on the plan that was submitted, and it's noted in the variance criteria to say, oh, there used to be this old thing here. Well, I think as the board noted, that went away once it was demolished. But I believe there's attempting to degrade the intent of 7.8B, which allowed them to build this structure, by introducing it as evidence to now create a new nonconformity.
Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? Nobody else here. We're going to close the public portion of the hearing down, and I would ask any other board members if, based upon anything that's come up thus far, if we have any more questions or comments on the application.
It would just be nice if there was a little more forethought here, because, like I say, if you'd have made this proposal when that old structure raised in July was still there, you wouldn't be here, I don't think. But that's a fait accompli, it's a done deal. We have a new situation.
John?
I guess the issue is I touched on, it's only, what, 4 months old, the construction. Had this been discussed at a later time, maybe some adjustments could have been made, but I can remember a case down off of Grove Street in which three homes were put up and they didn't meet the, in fact, that was the reason for justifying the foundation certification beforehand building. They came to the board after the houses were up, and the board at that time told them they weren't going to get the variances because it was new construction and they needed to move it back. This is a similar situation, and I know there has to be a second means of egress, and unless I'm all wet, which I could be,
the garage would be the same.
I'm not so sure the building code allows a second means of egress through a garage, unless
I don't know,
but maybe I'm all wet.
No.
But anyways, if there's already a slider there, you're going to have a platform of some type there, and the stairs coming down off of it. This is a tough area to work in to begin with. I mean, all the lots are small down there. In fact, most people would end up buying 2 and 3 and sometimes 4 of the 5,000 square foot lots just to make sure that they had the privacy. But the issue, I think, comes right back to can we give it, especially to the fact that it's new construction. Although I certainly would love to be able to see a creative design on the deck there, and go back to 15 feet, but the building inspector...
The best you could get is 15 foot, basically, and it's required to have 20.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. I get it. It still goes back to the issue of...
And that's what the building envelope...
Yes.
Shows on the
yes
survey plan 20 yep. foot setback.
Yeah, to fully comply with the 20 foot requirement, yeah. You can't
yeah,
put
so
a deck
the surveyor
there.
Had it right. He showed a building envelope, and the house takes up pretty much
yep.
all of the building envelope.
I do believe if we did put the deck on the plan, we would have to be here anyway. Huh? According to Glenn, if we were in the setbacks at all, we would have to come back here anyway for you guys to approve it. It might have been an easier process, but we still would have been. the back here, because it was still within the setback yard, so that we still would have to be back here.
It would have been lessening the non-conformity.
Yeah,
yeah.
We still would have.
Yeah.
I got you. Robin, any other comments? Okay. I'm gonna give, I guess, describe for the applicant what you've asked us to do, and given what you heard, give you some choices. You've asked us to vote on this petition tonight for a variance. You require 4 out of 5 votes in the affirmative to grant the variance. If you don't get 4 out of 5, you're barred for 2 years from raising this issue again.
And you'd have to come back with a substantially different proposal.
And unless the proposal is substantially different. So I don't know if anything related to a deck is going to be considered substantially different. Your other options are withdrawing the case and trying to figure something else out, or we could continue the case.
Talk to Glenn.
You could go and talk to Glenn and see if there's any meaningful way you want to come back and still look for the relief that you've asked for, perhaps altered in some meaningful way. Again, so 3 choices. We can vote on your case, which we're here, and we're happy to do our job and do that for you. You can withdraw the case if you don't want to, without prejudice, to refile it. Or you can continue the case to a later date. We're booking in early January right now, and have a discussion perhaps with the building inspector to see if something perhaps changes with regard to your application. And I'll give you those 3 choices. And if you guys want to talk about it, step out, or have a conversation where
step out for
we're
a couple
happy
of
to
minutes
wait for
if
you
like.
To,
and
no, we don't want to dump that on you and rush you.
Yeah, discuss it.
No, I think you're right. Everybody has that option anyway.
Right. But I figured we'd lay it out for them and let them know.
No, you're right. A lot of times people don't realize they have those options.
Right.
So how is town meeting shaping up now? Anybody? I mean, are we looking? This is the money issue, is it not?
No, they're gonna call a special town meeting inside of town meeting. But the warrant articles deal with regular town business issues, and then they're gonna open up a special town meeting to discuss, I believe. The crux of the discussion is going to be surrounding the litigation, the settlement of the high school litigation, if I recall correctly.
That's the only item on the
for a special town meeting that they're going to call in the middle of the town meeting. Our agenda tonight calls for minutes. Do we have minutes in our package?
No, there's nothing underneath, so you don't have any minutes.
Okay,
no.
All right, good.
Nothing.
Oh, really?
I just looked at the agenda sheet.
No,
set, and
she should have put down the date that was being...
You usually put the dates down.
Yeah.
Got it. All right,
right.
So that's just a form.
Yeah.
Boilerplate.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Got it. Good. Just want to make sure I wasn't missing something.
Wouldn't want you to miss anything, Dennis.
Sharp as a marble.
So we would like to withdraw the request.
Okay, without prejudice?
Without prejudice.
Okay. That would require a motion to approve the withdrawal and a brief write-up.
Brief write-up.
By a member. Would somebody like to make a motion? Go ahead, it's an easy one.
If you don't want to, I'll do it.
No, if you don't want to, we can have somebody else do it. If you don't
I'll move to
go ahead, si.
Grant the petitioner, MJP Properties, Inc., approval of their request to withdraw from case 1620 without prejudice.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by John. Any further discussion on the motion to withdraw? Hearing none, we'll take a vote. All those in favor? 5-0-0. Your motion to withdraw is granted.
Thank you
very much.
Have a nice evening.
You too.
Okay.
Yeah, I always put a little one together. Yeah, just in case. Doesn't take very long to do it. You know, I do it on all of them. I know Eric does it too. Only takes 5 or 10 minutes. Huh? Yeah.
All right, we don't have any other board business to discuss this evening, do we? Anybody, anything not on the agenda that anybody wants to bring up? We do have a hearing next week.
We do.
On the 40B. And we should all be prepared with comments and or questions relating to a draft decision so that we can have discussions regarding that on the record. And other than that, I think I'd entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
We have a second?
Second.
All right. All those in favor? We are adjourned. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.